Yo, internet. It's your boys, Wes Gardner and Marco Flores, brothering around episode number something.
Six.
Marco. Marco with the save right there. Cause I don't know what's going on.
I try to listen before we record, and yeah, I was just listening on the way home about what we were talking about. But episode number six.
Yeah, man.
I'll start it out with this. I did not vote for Trump, but a part of me is excited for the age of the Hunger Games, Purge, Lucha Underground, year one. Right. Until I actually get got, and then that's it.
That's right, man. Over. Then it's done. Yeah, game over. You're done. Like, and then it's But dude, you're studying boxing. You're studying Muay Thai type stuff. So you're gonna last pretty long.
I'm gonna work for Dario really soon.
Right. My big bodybuilder ass is gonna be lugging around. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, there's the giant guy that can't fit through the door frame. Let me get him first.
Oh, dude.
That's what's gonna happen. But dude, I don't know what the fuck's going on. I don't know what episode this is. I don't know. It's topsy turvy land. Like, my brain is so done right now.
You sound like you're disoriented, as if like there was some big thing that happened.
Some big dramatic American event of bizarro backwards land. Like, you know, in Star Trek, whenever it was Bizarro World and Spock had the goatee, like, we just all need to grow out the goatee. Right now, that evil twin goatee right now, because
Earth
that's
to Wes Gardner and Marco Flores.
Right. And our podcast is called Around Brothering. So it's like, it's all
that is tremendous.
Around Brothering.
Brothering.
Welcome to fucking backwards land. But okay, there's a rule. We've been podcasting for a long time. We've been making content. There's a rule that we always abide by, and it's like a pact. And a lot of entertainment people make this pact. No religion, no politics. Basically, if it can't fly in the workplace, don't do it on the radio. Not unless you're like a shock jock or, you know what I mean? Like, don't dabble into that stuff, because you know what? You don't want to offend somebody. You don't want your entertainment should not usually be the place where you really question your morality or something, like what your belief systems are. A lot of times that's not what you're listening for. You're listening for fun gags or like video game news, or like, depending on what you're in it for, going kind of that 180 isn't really what people signed up for, you know?
Yeah.
But today we make an exception, and Marco and I have not actually spoken about the election yet. So I'm interested kind of what your thoughts on this, but I'll begin. I have three main points, three. Number one, I know we have listeners from all around the world. I know we have a lot of listeners here in America. We love all of you, like, genuinely, like, no matter what your racial background, no matter what your sexual orientation, no matter what your belief systems are, no matter what your religious decisions and the way you live your life, you are loved. Just know that. It's something that I, from the bottom of my heart, I truly feel that I love humanity. I love diversity. I love learning about things I don't know about. That's what gets me up in the morning. Like, I get to learn something new today. There's a whole bunch of shit about this world I know nothing about, and that excites me because now I have an opportunity to learn more. Donald Trump does not speak for everyone. For a lot of people. However, we talked about this before the show, and I will go there. The big reason why Donald Trump was elected was uneducated and educated white men and women. Now, there's a lot of like American turmoil happening right now. You have this whole Black Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter stuff. Just very tense. It's a very tense atmosphere. And I, being a white male, I'm a straight white guy. I'm Tumblr's worst nightmare. So. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we're going all out. Hey, man, if we're going all out, let's go all out. So And while we're saying this, like, I genuinely don't mean to 100% offend anybody, but I'm telling you what I'm thinking right now in a land of disarray, and where are we going, and what is America about, and we really have to do a lot of soul searching here. So I'm the straight white guy. So I am the problem. Like, if people are on Facebook, people are on Twitter, they're going to blame the straight white guy. Mm. I can tell you, not... yes, there is a problem. Absolutely, there is an institutionalized something happening here in America. I fucking hate it. I know the elections were made by people who owned slaves, so it's going to work in their favor.
Right.
Like, that's just... I fucking hate it. I hate that shit. I'm proud of who I am. I'm a proud Irish guy. I love my heritage. But stuff's shitty. And I hate that whole saying, like, not all men or not all this or not all people. But genuinely, that is not the voice of the majority. That fucking hate-filled, vitriol, immigrants aren't wanted here, that type of shit does not fly. It doesn't fly in my house. It better not fly in my family. Like, I have no patience for it. Period. Like, the thing that really, truly upsets me, I have a 4-year-old little girl. Whenever you're a parent, or let's say you have a nephew, or you have a small child learning the ways of the world that is part of your life, a cousin, anything, you teach them the basics of humanitarianism. Don't be a bully. Treat people with respect. Treat people how you would want to be treated. Listen to other people's opinions. You may not agree with them, but value them. People have lived their lives in such a way that they have experiences. You should value and empathize with those experiences as best you can. Really listen to people. And then who do we go and fucking elect? Somebody that doesn't do any of that shit. He's the biggest fucking bully on television. He's a reality TV star. Like, that's how he got famous. He thought he was hot shit in the 80s, but he went to debt 11 times. Like, you know what I'm saying? This guy's full of horse shit. But he won.
He won.
How in the hell did this happen? How did we get here?
That guy's a true heel.
Oh, a monster mega. That's real mega heat. Heel. That ain't cheap heat that you say, like, oh, Biloxi, yeah, Mississippi, you all smell bad. Like, right. It's not cheap heat. This is real fucking, like, people are spray painting swastikas on Trump Tower type shit.
Dude.
Like,
just on the news, as soon as the results were in, some building in San Francisco put up a Nazi swastika flag.
What the fuck, like, is going on?
What the hell is
we turned some corner. I don't know what, but that is not okay. I mean, we, you know, it's the old Nitro Beard and Beardcast stuff. We would never really take stands. Even though we would talk about it in private, we never publicly published it on a thing. I'm here to say, yeah, we brothering around don't stand for that type of horse shit. Like, get that the fuck out of here. Because that's not even, I can't even respect that with a response. You know what I mean? Right. Like, it's not worth the shit on your shoes. So, and the third thing.
So before going in, I just wanted to say, like, before going in, like, hearing about the results, were in, like, in your head, you were just assuming or expecting that Hillary would win because there, people really don't want Trump to become president.
Sure.
Because I was totally thinking that on the way home, and, you know.
Yeah. And I think that's the problem. I think they did their victory lap on the 30-yard line. You know what I mean? Didn't quite make the touchdown. They didn't quite score the goal, but they were celebrating preemptively because, hey, there's no way Trump could win. And I think I really do hold the Democratic Party reliable or accountable for that.
Responsible?
Yeah. Yeah, they are responsible for that. Yes. Like, they dropped the fucking ball. You had arguably, and, you know, we won't even talk about, because this could be a whole podcast about this, but we're not even going to talk about the fucking allegations on either side and all this other stuff. That's a whole different ballgame. But you could argue that, and this is my third point, and this is the part that genuinely breaks my heart. And I mean, being a father of a daughter, I could be reading into this, but this is genuinely how I feel. You're telling me that a woman with 30 years of public service experience, her husband was actually the president of the United States. She's worked in the Senate. She's worked in the White House. She's worked in all these places her entire adult life. She basically trained her entire adult life to become president of the United States. She still lost to a guy that's not even a politician, because that's how little we value responsible women in America. How do I tell my daughter that? Try your best, honey. Go get 4 master's degrees. Be the best at what you do, but then hope some rich douchebag doesn't have friends in high places. Yeah, breaks my heart, man. Like, that's, to me, it's a symbolic thing.
You and every other parent that is dealing with that can't understand how to even explain that to their child.
Like, how do you do it? And now you're, like, daycares are going to be more, you know, I mean, we'll see. There's no way of knowing right now. It's still way too early. It's a fresh wound. I can say, and here's the deal, I'm from Texas. I am definitely, Texas and Oklahoma are totally Trump country. I work with a lot of Trump supporters. I genuinely asked them today, that, like I was telling Marco, if we would have recorded this last night at 3 a.m., I would have been screaming for 4.5 hours into this microphone. I was beside myself. Oh, it would have been a bad time. But I had the pleasure to talk with these people, and they made the decision that they genuinely thought was the best for the country. And as part of a democracy, I have to respect that. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's part of the process. It isn't sour grapes that my person didn't win. It's, I don't like the hateful rhetoric that came out of this. I don't like the fact that it was okay to be able to, like, be angry at someone because of their religious beliefs. I don't like that. Like, that's the part that is poison to me. That's poison. Now, I've seen people do the whole, like, both sides are bad, and, oh, well, both of them would have been Hitler, or, like, whatever. There's so much hyperbole out there that you have to cut through. I just know how it affects me personally, and it does break my heart to, how genuinely can I tell my daughter, don't be a bully if bullies get whatever they want?
Yeah.
That's what breaks my heart, man. And, I mean, those are my 3 kind of main points on it. Well, I think one of my other points is that, I can't fathom the fact, because I'm a huge Teddy Roosevelt guy. That's kind of my favorite president. He was one of those guys. He was just, you know, did great things. I didn't agree with everything he did, but there was a badass, a genuine badass. He looked out for, like, park preservations. He let the press in to the White House to actually cover politics. Like, he did a lot. He is now, Teddy Roosevelt and Donald Trump had the same job.
Oh, wow.
You know what I'm saying? Teddy Roosevelt would have punched. Right. I hate it. Like, Teddy Roosevelt would have punched him unconscious, slapped him back awake, and then punched him out again. Because Teddy Roosevelt don't fuck around, boy. Teddy Roosevelt. Yeah. I'll tell you a story about Teddy Roosevelt. 2 stories. Teddy Roosevelt was about to give a speech. Can't remember what state he was in. And he got shot. Someone shot him. They tried to assassinate Teddy Roosevelt. He pulled the paper out of his, like, breast pocket where he got shot, unfolded the paper, and said, "It takes more than that to kill a bull moose." And then did his speech with a bullet. He did the whole speech. A 45-minute nice. Speech. What a badass. And then after he, you know, his buddies were sailing the Mississippi River after he got out of office. And then, you know, they docked for a little bit, and they went and they, you know, get drinks or something. Some guy steals his boat. Like, someone steals Teddy Roosevelt's boat. So he's angry. So him and his friends build another boat. They build a boat, chase after this guy, and then beat his ass and take his boat back. So awesome. Like, oh, that's awesome. He would leave. Teddy Roosevelt would leave for months at a time, and no one knew where he went. He's the president. And he's like, peace, y'all. And he would just leave. Like, what a baller. Like, that guy's...
I got to do an RPG quest.
Yeah, I'll be back. I'll be up to the Everglades. Peace. Like, yeah. I'm at Yosemite National Park. See ya.
Yeah.
Like,
real life Skyrim.
Yeah. Teddy Roosevelt is real life Skyrim. He's the Rough Rider, man. That Rough Rider.
Oh, yeah.
Spanish War. But he's now in the same breath. Donald Trump is now in the same breath as Teddy Roosevelt, Abraham Lincoln. What the fuck? Yeah. Like, the guy from The Apprentice? It's like if you voted in Kim Kardashian.
You know?
He's such a good businessman. Well, Kim Kardashian sold fucking billion emojis. Should she be president now? Like, what? What's the new litmus test for getting into this office?
Yeah.
That's what makes me upset about it, man. Just the rhetoric. And, like, I can't stand hate. I love people too much. I don't know. Maybe I'm a bleeding heart liberal, whatever. Like, but I like meeting people and learning about people and eating food I've never had before. And that's it, man. Yeah. That's what life is. You do new things and you do new experiences. And the fact that there are so many people in America that want things to go back to, like, Leave It to Beaver time just makes me very upset. Very upset.
Yeah.
But like I said, I've talked with a lot of Trump supporters, and really they voted because they are not happy with the political system. And I mean, to be fair, Hillary won the popular vote, but she doesn't win the presidency. There's something wrong. You know what I mean? Like, so there's something to be said about maybe the system needs a shakeup. But at what cost? Whenever your first main supporter is David Duke to come out, literally the guy who created the KKK, and he says, I'm so happy that Trump won. We had a big part in this election.
Our people.
Holy shit. What? Like,
yeah.
That's on another level, man. I don't, just for everyone out there, whether you're American, if you're overseas, we don't know what the fuck's going on either. Like, we really don't. It's a weird time. We're going to get through it. The best thing you can do is love the people that you love. Make people feel safe. Let them know that they are wanted. They are loved. Spread that message. That's how we win. That's how decency wins.
Yeah.
My take on it, man.
Good luck. Good luck, Trump, for going towards any of the Hillary won states. Good luck going to California.
Yeah.
Good luck, don't go to Oakland. Oakland right now.
Shit.
Good, Trump. You know, seriously. You know, for your well-being, do not go to, just don't go to California. You're not wanted there right now. And I don't know how long it'll take, but you're just not wanted there.
Yeah.
You know, it's crazy out there.
It was already tense. And now this is just, if that pot hasn't boiled over yet, man.
So, dude, I woke up this morning and I watched the news, and there was already at 4, 3, 5 in the morning, fires and burning protests up in Oakland.
Shit.
And I live 15 minutes away from Oakland.
Yeah.
So they're up and at it already, just riots and all that stuff. And I think today they have another protest that happened at 5 p.m. And I was trying to get home before I drive into all that mess that's going on. So luckily I got home fine. Cause yesterday, geez, I try to leave work and it took me 2 hours to get home, and that doesn't normally happen because everybody decides they want to leave at the same time and try to get to wherever, their nearest polling places, to get their votes in before, it closes. And I was just stuck in traffic. Like, dude, come on, man. You know, it sucked trying to go home. But Oakland is, I'm glad I'm not there right now because it's terrible.
Just upheaval. And I mean, and of course, we at Brothering Around, love, not war type of thing. Yeah. Like, you can make your voice heard without resorting to violence. So please, let's stay somewhat civil. But I mean, I understand the unrest. Like, I literally went to bed, I think this morning at about 3 something, because I stayed up to watch everything. Mm-hmm. And you know, we're not going to talk about policy and stuff on the podcast, but like, there are people with certain beliefs that are now in the White House, or that will be in the White House and in the Senate and Congress and the House, mm-hmm. that is scary.
Yeah.
It's scary, especially for our friends that are, you know, lesbian, gay, bi, transgender, queer. Mm-hmm. It's yeah. scary. And I mean, that's why genuinely, like, both of us, like, it's, you are loved. Like, please just stay with people that you trust. Like, just get through it. Get through it.
So I can speak for, as a minority, because I'm Filipino.
Yes.
And
yes.
I can genuinely tell you that the people that, like, you know, Trump, you know, took, you know, just slandered and attacked, mm-hmm. they are genuinely frightened of the results and what's going to happen. Like, yeah, like you said, you know, the LGBT community is terrified because, you know, they might get their, you know, their rights revoked. You know, Obamacare might, you know, go away, you know, and then like the whole Mexican thing that he was mentioning. And now he's talking about Canadians, calling them snow Mexicans type of thing. Everybody as a minority is frightened of what's going to happen. I'm a little scared myself, you know, because if I deport me and I'm, you know, I was born here. So like, I'm an American right. citizen, but he still might just deport me to the Philippines. Cause you know,
different how you look, color man. Skin. You're right.
But,
you're
you know,
right.
it's for me now is just, well, okay, well, you got it. Now what are you going to do? Are you going
right.
to actually say what you're going to say, or just you're going to, you know, change everything up and, like, make it like a whole reboot of the whole system. Like, right. I'm waiting to see, because everybody was, I was, for the first time in a while, I was glued to my Facebook feed because everybody just had some sort of input of yeah. the election results. And, you know, everybody was super serious, while I'm over here posting pictures of, like, 2015, like, I can't believe Trump is going to be, you know, trying to run for president again. 2016, can President Trump really do that? And then 2017 yeah. I'm really excited for the first Hunger Games. I hope my district wins.
Yeah, like, yeah. I think that's what's partly the scariest thing, is we have yeah. no idea what Donald Trump's going to do, because his entire campaign, he didn't speak about a single thing of policy.
Right.
It was all just slamming Clinton. So we don't know what Trump's about. We have no clue, because he never talked about it.
Yeah.
There's a certain portion of America that I'm very disappointed in, but it makes me want to get back into sales, because if they're that naive and that easily gullible, I could sell them.
You'll make a killing.
Oh, I would sell them bubble gum and a lockjaw ward. I'll sell them fucking swamp water in Florida, baby. Like, yeah. let's make some money off these
yeah.
doofuses. And there's no other term, but anyone who's actively, like, just openly racist and a bigot and, oh, make America great again. You mean make America white again.
Right.
Like, that type of shit. No.
I mean, that's really the one good thing that the results of Trump winning is, like, they flagged all the bigots.
Yep.
The racists.
It's
the
out.
Sexists. It's out there. You can't hide right now.
Public profile,
you're
baby.
All there.
That's
you're all
you
there,
are.
Man.
Yep. We saw you in mass.
Yeah.
We heard your voice, but guess what? Now we know who spoke up.
Right.
So that's yeah. It's these people are on the wrong side of history.
Yeah.
I always are. You look back at the whole, like, I'm Irish. You would see old pictures from like the 20s and 30s that said no Irish allowed. You saw mm-hmm. the whole yep. before the Civil Rights Act stuff came in for the voting rights in the 60s, you know, separate water fountains. That shit yeah. is archaic. It's archaic. It's draconian. It's out of date. And the thing is, that rhetoric is the thing that won. And it doesn't mean that it's doom and gloom World War III, that we're going to go back to separate water fountains and shit. But it came from the same place. And that's mm-hmm. what bugs me so much. Is like, I thought we... I know there's hate in people's hearts, And I hope them the best, and that whatever fucked them up, that changes and they get better. Like, just get better, get healthy, learn about the world around you. Like, just be a better person. Be a better person. It's frustrating. It all boils down to that. It's just, yeah. I don't know. We don't know. We're the rest of the world watching America. We don't know either.
We'll see what happens.
I mean, take solace. There's something that I always go back to. Any time of tragedy, there was a quote by Mr. Rogers, and he said, anytime something terrible would happen and we would watch it on the news, you know, Mr. Rogers' mother would say, look for the people that are helping.
Mm-hmm.
That's all you got to look at. Yeah. Look at for the people. Look at the 70 million or 60 million people that voted. They made their voice heard. That they did not stand up to bigotry, or they did stand up to bigotry. They do not accept it. You know, hateful rhetoric is not welcome. That's the thing. Just remember, there is a mass amount of people, the majority, in fact, that does not abide by those rules that Donald Trump has put into place. I don't know, man. Like, we'll see.
We'll see. Training all weapons, you might get selected for the Hunger Games.
Get your nunchucks out.
Yeah, get your nunchucks. Learn a bow and arrow.
A crossbow.
A trident.
Okay, so, well, Hunger Games. Hunger Games weapon. What would you take? Any weapon. What would you do?
That's tough. That is tough. Because I also have some sort of expertise in like Eskrima, which is basically Filipino martial arts.
Yeah.
And that's like stick fighting, but like really the stick fighting is like big ass knives. I may go that route. I may go, I may go the bow and arrow as well. You know, not try to be close contact until I have to use it, right?
Yeah. Yeah, keep that knife on the side and kind of...
Right, you know?
You need that stealth advantage because people will only come after you if they can find you.
You need your distance. Yeah, totally.
That's right. Yeah.
This may happen.
Right.
I keep joking about it, but like, dude, this may happen.
Oh, such a mess. But on this episode of Brothering Around, so we covered all the election stuff and
dude, this week has been busy. Like,
it has.
You were just talking about BlizzCon, like, over the weekend.
Oh, shit. Yeah, let's talk about BlizzCon for a minute.
You know? Yeah.
Holy God. Okay. So, with BlizzCon, I'm kind of pissed. Kind of.
Yeah, how do you feel generally about it?
Kind of not wanting to deal with BlizzCon anymore. Because I'm realizing slowly but surely that Blizzard is not a company that's making games for me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So what ended up happening is whenever you buy a virtual ticket for BlizzCon, it's like $40. You get all access to all these, you know, press conferences and, you know, like specials and tournaments and all this stuff. Well, the esports tournaments are free. You can watch them on Twitch, at any time. They're free for everybody. You don't have to pay for the virtual ticket to see the grand finals of StarCraft. Like, you can just watch it for free. So what ends up happening? So there's a number of things. So going into BlizzCon, what I was looking forward to is the Diablo 20th anniversary. Mm-hmm. I was looking forward to what news they had about World of Warcraft. I was interested to hear what they had to say about any future news, like any reveals, especially high def remakes of older games. We talked last episode about the Necromancer reveal, and was that for Diablo 3 or was that for straight on Diablo 4? Like, so there was a lot kind of going into it. So the first day, I load up the stream and I realize that there are 5 full rooms of like panel rooms that we do not have access to as virtual ticket owners. So there's a total of 36 press conferences that we don't get to see. They just locked us
in string at all.
Not at all. They didn't have video coverage, nothing.
Oh, you just had to be there for those panels.
Bingo. And yeah. They were all of the ones that I was kind of interested in, you know, level design, game mechanics, engineering, like, you know, how the sausage is made kind of stuff. Like, here's how we make the video games that you love. Right. And here's interviews with the voice actors and the cinematographers that bring the cutscenes together. Like, all of the in and outs of making a video game, off limits. So you have these main panels. There's one main panel for a retrospective of Blizzard, which is pretty good. They brought back some old people and, like, talk shop, and that was interesting and a lot of fun, and they had funny stories. But instead of those, like, 30-some-odd conferences, they were like, but this year, good news, you get to watch all the esports. It's like, we could have fucking already watched the esports for free.
Yeah.
Like, that's our consolation, is you're giving us free things that everyone gets. We gave you money. Like, what are you doing? And then, so you get in-game goodies and stuff. So all of that stuff, I need to check all my games because it's probably there now. But, you know, they send you all that stuff. But then, so the Diablo announcement. They're like, we remade Diablo 1. And we're like, oh, shit, that's awesome. And it's like, we remade Diablo 1. In Diablo 3, and it's a quest line. Oh,
just like, a quest line?
Yeah. So it's like, okay, so it's like a 16-level dungeon, and now it just happens once a year, so it's a repeating thing now. It's an event that happens every year, and it's going to come out in January. And then they're like, and we brought out the Necromancer, and everyone's like, oh, cool. And they're like, it's for Diablo 3, which we're like, okay, sure, fine. And it comes out December 2017.
That's a good while.
What the fuck? Like, what?
Yeah.
A year? A calendar year has to pass for this shit? Like, we see it in gameplay right now, and it has all the abilities, and like, what are you talking about? We have to wait a solid year. I think they're buying time. I think they're buying time. Because they pulled a lot of the Diablo team to work on a new project. Maybe it's Diablo 4. Maybe it's not. Who knows? But, like, so that kind of left a sour taste. Then there was a Blizzard roundtable panel. And then the question was brought up. So, what are your thoughts on bringing high-def remasters of, you know, like, Diablo 1 and Diablo 2 and Warcraft 1 and 2? And, you know, the crowd roars. People want to know about it. So their answer, I
mean, there's a demand there, right?
Like, a huge demand.
People want to see remakes, right?
And they have, and they have Battle.net, which is their online service. It's kind of like Steam.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you download all your game clients. So they have a shop already that you could just go buy it. You know, $20. Who, you know, there it is. But their answer was, well, we have all of the source code. We have all of the assets, so like graphics. But in the office, we played the games, and they're not very fun anymore. So we're just going to work on the future. That was the official answer for these people that are like, you basically just said, we have everything to make this happen, but fuck you.
Yeah.
Like, fuck you. That's why why we're not doing it, because fuck you. That's why. Right? So suck it, and congratulations, and we're not doing it. And then you could just feel the air in the room just like, like,
sucked out.
Totally. Like the Price is Right horn played. And you're like, the fuck?
Yeah.
So then they have that. Then they talk about, well, we're going to cut from this panel that we have right now because we're going to the esports section. Fuck the esports section. This is, what are you doing? Like, you're giving us free content and making us pay $40 for it. And then the whole thing. The whole thing was so disingenuous. And, like, the real main panels... Okay, so Diablo is their 20th anniversary. There was one Diablo panel, and that was the one where they announced the Necromancer and the dungeon and all that stuff. The other four Diablo panels, they were locked in those 36 that we didn't have access to.
Hmm.
So, congratulations, Diablo, for your 20-year anniversary. Fuck you. We're going to put you on... So this was the whole BlizzCon. The whole experience was like this. And
over the weekend, like reading your tweets, you just sounded whelmed.
Yeah.
Underwhelmed.
It was. And it, because I started off so psyched and the opening thing was so cool and they did a reveal on an Overwatch character. But basically, they're really putting their horse on Overwatch and Hearthstone, the card game.
And esports.
Right? And esports. So guess what? Three things I am not interested in. Those Overwatch, Hearthstone, and fucking esports. Yeah. So that's why I feel like Blizzard is kind of like, oh, okay. And then with the World of Warcraft news, they're like, we're adding flying to World of Warcraft Legion, you know, because they have flying in every expansion. And then the crowd claps, and then we're like, oh, when is it available? It's available late next year. And you have to do this entire quest chain and get revered a reputation with four factions. And so basically, it's the biggest fucking time sink. It's like 200 hours of bullshit that you have to do.
Just to fly.
Just to fly around in a fucking place we've already been in for a year. Like, well, come on. Like, what is going on? And they have this kind of smug attitude about it because now they're making so much money with Hearthstone and Overwatch, they don't give a fuck. And that's why I started feeling like, okay, maybe Blizzard isn't for me anymore. And that breaks my heart to say because I'm a old school Blizzard fanboy. Mm. I think the first PC game I bought with my own money was Warcraft 2. So I go way back, man. I'm going to like 96, 97. You know,
so lost. So did you buy Overwatch when it came out?
Yes.
And it just didn't grab you?
It's a shooter. I can only get so into shooters. It's just one of those genres that, like, I can play through a campaign, but any multiplayer competitive style game, I got to be really into it in order to deal with a bunch of people online.
Yeah, because as far as I understand, it's their version of TF2.
That's exactly right. Yes.
Right? Yeah. Okay.
So it's class-based. You have a scout, you have an engineer, you have a healer, you have snipers, you have... Yeah. So it's based on that way. You have objective-based maps where it's like a capture the flag or you're doing an escort mission and like that type of... So it's fun. Don't get me wrong. It's just that's not my jam. Like I'm the RPG guy. I'm the guy that likes to power level stuff and break stuff. That's what I'm into. With that, everything's super balanced, and oh, we have new patches coming to alleviate the stress of Widowmaker, and like all the, and I'm like, I don't care. and it's the same thing with Hearthstone. Like, here's a game that is so insanely, like, deep isn't the right word because it's a really easy game to get into. But okay, so it's like me asking to get into comics. It's like, oh, where do you fucking begin? You know, where do you begin? Yeah. Where do you start? Because it's so big now. There's like 700 cards and there's five expansions and they're changing the meta all the time. And it's a competitive card game worth $2 million cash pool and like all this other. And you're like, it's like trying to hop into Magic the Gathering now. It's just like there's so much to look over. And if you're not in from the beginning, you're kind of just left out, you know? So. That they're just going that way and it makes them money. I can't blame them. But, you know, this is the house that Diablo built. This is the house that Warcraft built. And now it's the Overwatch and Hearthstone company.
Yeah.
So it's just different. It's either that or I'm getting older. It's another thing of those damn kids and their card games. You know, like it's just.
I mean, I guess, you know, whatever it takes to make the money so they can make, I mean, I'm still waiting for World of StarCraft because that's the only game franchise that I'm really into.
Yeah.
You know, make, had those games make money so you can make, you know, the actual games that people want.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Actors do that. They do that AAA Hollywood bullshit so they can, you know, eat while they're doing their really passion project indie film.
Sure.
You know, that's kind of how it rolls. But so, I mean, I can't blame them for making money, but the whole thing just felt really sort of like bait and switch. Like, oh, you spent $40, so here's all the free esports things. And I'm like, this is not what I signed up for. Literally, this is not what I signed up for.
You're not going to try to go for your own esports what it, I mean, that was the one thing I heard about BlizzCon is like, I don't know if it's each city having their own team or each
Overwatch,
state
Overwatch League.
Yeah.
You could get like, on the leaderboards and you could be the guy from fucking.
So you don't want to be like.
I'm the guy from Biloxi, Mississippi.
Yeah. And I'm, Oklahoma, whatever.
I'm the best. I'm the best Texas. Reinhardt. Yeah, I'm the best Texas Toblerone or whatever his name is.
That's a candy.
Delicious. Well, now there's outrage about that. Did you see that? They changed the way Toblerones look.
No.
And people are pissed. People are just fucking angry. The world's in an angry spot right
now.
I'm mad at BlizzCon. America's mad at minorities. Like, I don't know what's happening anymore.
And Toblerone. Yeah.
Toblerone. People were pissed about the chocolate bar. Like, I don't know. Yeah. People are just very up in arms right now about a lot of things. Oh, what a world. Okay. So, on a more positive note, before we get into, like, Superior Spider-Man.
Before all that.
Okay.
Young Justice 3, Season 3. Justice Season 3 got announced. That's what I'm really happy about.
Yeah, man.
If you never watched, I mean, that's the thing I would recommend to you is,
yeah,
if you want to watch, I mean, DC animation is always good quality animation, like cartoons.
Yeah.
Watch Young Justice. It's on Netflix. It's teen superheroes trying to prove themselves to their, you know, like Batman, you know, like Robin trying to prove himself to Batman.
Gotcha.
Superboy trying to prove himself to the Superman. It's all the juniors, you know, of the legacy characters getting formed into a team, into a covert team, like almost black op missions, but for the teenagers. Like, really? You're gonna use teenagers for those missions? But it's a really cool show. I would definitely recommend you watch it. It's
Heck yeah, man.
It's awesome.
And I'm glad you have Netflix because my recommendation, you know how we do the weekly recommendations. Yes, I do. And I believe it's on Netflix. I need to double check, but it has been for a long, long, long time. You may just have to search for it. But anyway, we'll get to that at the end. You might have to remind me. But on the other positive note, speaking of our new Brothering Around tradition, you had me watch the first episode of an anime entitled Tiger Mask W.
Yeah.
And I watched
it, man.
And I adore it. It's so
it's awesome.
Absurd. And the most hilarious. Like, it is the type of thing that I wish like we live closer together because I would record a video of us riffing while we're watching these episodes, like Mystery Science Theater, because that's what it's set up to be. So for those that don't know, it's like, we went over it a little bit last episode, but in New Japan Pro Wrestling, there is a, where did Tiger Mask originate from? Was it All Japan?
That my history is sketchy on that. I want to say maybe All Japan.
All Japan. And that the first one was, Sawara, right? Or, the first actual Tiger Mask, like real life one. So Tiger Mask is actually this, I'm trying to think of something that like a WWE audience would have an equivalent of.
Tiger Mask would be
not like
funny enough. He would be the CM Punk after the pipe bomb.
Yeah.
Oh, but you just watched episode one. Okay.
Right.
See, that's the thing that they talk about the, like, you know, the Tiger Mask before him, because
it's funny and like,
because go ahead.
Oh yeah, well, the real life Tiger Mask is this tradition that's like passed down to people.
Yeah.
So the way it works in real life is like there was a Tiger Mask, and then there was a Tiger Mask 2, and then there was a Tiger Mask 3, and then there was a Tiger Mask 4. So like, and like Tiger Mask 4 was a Mitsuharu Misawa, I think. Like, so these are the guys, like these are the greatest Japanese wrestlers maybe of all time are given the mantle of Tiger Mask, and they get to, but I'm trying to think of like an American equivalent, but I can't quite, it's almost like, it's more like a belt than it is a thing, you know, like a gimmick. It's more of like you are given Tiger Mask and now you get to embody everything that Tiger Mask is, this continued pursuit of excellence. Like, so there's really this genuine kind of work around it. Like,
I think you would correlate it to like the super baby face, like your Hogan's, like your,
yeah,
your John Cena's, your Roman Reigns, but like, it doesn't hate it though.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't have that same backlash that the fans don't like it. Yeah. The fans really respect who is chosen. Like, this is, you are almost knighted. Like, in professional wrestling, it's a version of being knighted. So this is an anime based on a Tiger Mask and Tiger the Dark. Which that makes me laugh too.
I love the was that Miss X, how she pronounced it, Tiger of the Doku.
Tiger the Doku. Oh, and it's so dramatic, and it has flashing lights, and he does a pose where he takes off a cape, and like, I wish wrestling was like this. I really do.
He always runs in and out of the ring
with a flying cape, like he's just sprinting Ultimate Warrior style, just like it's so funny. And in the first episode, Okada was in there, and then you know they're the New Japan Pro Wrestling deal, and they're at, what is it called, WrestleMax. WrestleMax.
And, WrestleMax,
so they really hype this thing up, and it's like WrestleMania, and Okada is like, let us show them the meaning of being a true warrior. And I was like, wrestling writing just needs to be this all the time, because I would be way fucking into it, like I'm not already, but like, it's so dumb. It's on the verge of like Dolph Ziggler's Colonel Sanders. Like, that's what I want. I just give me that. Just give
when
me
he
this.
Rips, when he rips the suit and he gets like his
the small little tie.
Yeah,
I laugh. I belly laugh every time I see it because he's in the Colonel Sanders.
And he's super serious, straight face.
Very straight face. And then he rips off his deal and he's in like a tank top and he's all ripped.
Yeah.
But he has that little Colonel, the little bow tie, a little black Kentucky bow tie. Oh my god! But it's like pasted to his pecs or something. It's just the funniest. Oh my god. But that's what Tiger Mask W is. Like, it is 25 minutes of that.
Yeah.
Just encompass. So, and like, what the thing that got kind of dark for me, I'll say this. So in the opening scene, a dude gets like what basically German suplexed off the top rope and he gets paralyzed. And then, like, they come to a scene later where he's, like, at a home. And at first, I thought he was a vegetable. And I was like,
yeah, you know,
what?
I thought he died.
They
showed that scene. Yeah.
And, like, I was like, that's not cool because, like, Mitsuharu Misawa actually did die in the ring.
Yeah.
Like, that's what happened. And I was like, what the fuck is this? Like, are they doing this right now? Like, I thought they were turning that corner. And I was like, they killed Yeah, they basically took a tragic event in Japanese wrestling history and made a fucking cartoon about it. But then later they cut to one of the young lions, you know, the guy that's like, I'm going to avenge my master. One of the young lions goes to visit that guy that got the pile driver off the top rope, and he's in a wheelchair and he's like looking at beautiful flowers. And at first I thought he was a vegetable, and I was like, oh my god, because you remember Draws back in the day. Like,
oh yeah.
The dude with the ponytail, and he was on that documentary Beyond the Mat. He actually got paralyzed, like vegetable. Yeah. So I was like, they can't do a Draws thing. Like, oh my god. Like, so for a minute there my heart sank. I was like, oh, what? But then then he really responded and he talked and he could move his arms and stuff. And I was like, okay. So he's in the wheelchair just recovering. Oh, like, it freaked me out for a minute. Like, I was like, oh, they can't do the paralyzed storyline. Like, don't do that. That's fucked up. But but then they're like, be sure to watch tonight, and I'll show you, what is it? I'll show you the spirit of a true man or something. And I burst out laughing.
Yeah.
Then they get to WrestleMax. And they get there, and Okada's there, and he's like, let us show the true meaning of the warrior. And then they go out and Tiger the Dark does his thing.
Wait. Go back. Go rewind it a little bit. The tryout. The Tiger Den tryout. Dude.
Oh my God.
That's what I was saying last episode. Like, that can't be real tryouts. People would die. And people died.
Genuinely, people did die during the tryout. Yeah. So, what this is okay, whenever you think of a training montage, just for anything, you think, okay, here's a guy, he's eating pork chops. He's like running stairs.
1,000 squats.
Yeah, he's doing some, hack squats. He's doing some punches on a meat hook or whatever. Like, that sort of training montage. So, this fucking training montage has these guys that are in their they're in their little wrestling Ric Flair like underwear onesie type thing, and they're wrestling boots, and like they have their taped wrist, so it looks like they're about to go to a wrestling match.
Yeah.
So they climb a mountain.
Free climb, no ropes.
They free climb, no ropes, no belay, no architecture, nothing. They are free climb. A blizzard.
Yeah. So just, real.
Just climbing thousands of feet in the air. And there's one guy that's like, I know that you're the superior tiger, or you're the superior candidate for Tiger Mask, but I'm going to kill you. So he grabs his ankle, and then the guy who ends up being Tiger of the Dark is like, haha, you won't get the best of me. And then like backflips off a mountain. And like grabs the guy and tosses him, kills a man. He kills a man. He kills a guy. He throws, and then there's a rope. Okay, so the part I think the biggest belly laugh of the whole episode, and this is for free. You can watch this on Crunchyroll. You can watch it. Just look up Tiger Mask W.
Yeah.
So then there's between the two mountains to get to the canyon to where the secret den is to where they get Tiger Mask. There's a rope bridge.
Yeah.
So instead of walking on the rope bridge like any normal fucking human being would, he does it like monkey bars under it.
Yeah.
Like he goes across with his arms like flexing and oh, I'm gonna make it and I'm gonna prove that I'm the best. Like, why don't you just walk on the bridge? Like, they built that bridge specifically to walk on. To go from one canyon to the other. But he used it like monkey bars. So then he gets in this den. And he's met by Vincent McMahon, basically.
Yeah.
With the whip. And like she's in a dominatrix outfit for some reason.
Tight leather suit, yeah.
Yeah, it's anime. And she has enormous boobs. Like the most hilariously size triple L boobs.
Yeah.
And she was like, you've made it this far. You are the true candidate for Tiger Mask the Daku. And so they pull this out and she screams it at him and like holds up this mask. And then he grabs this tiny little mask and like just stares, doesn't blink, and like puts on the mask. And then everyone else comes in the room and they're like, oh, so I guess you're Tiger Mask.
Yeah.
That's the reveal. It's like, oh, I guess he got it. All right. Like, and it's a very anticlimactic after the reveal of like the mask and everything. People just walk in and like, all right, so that's how that goes. And then they cut. God, there's so much that happened in this first episode. It was 23 minutes and each frame was a painting. It was just art that we're going to get that guy from the Skyrim review to just review Tiger Mask.
Right.
How beautiful and realistic. That show's hilarious. I'm going to watch episode 2 tomorrow at work, and I'm going
to
laugh.
You need to watch it. Yeah, like, you need to watch it.
I think they're up to episode 6 or 7 or something like that.
Yeah, so. Up to episode 6.
Oh, my God. But, dude, hilarious. It was a great recommendation. But now I'm bummed that not all wrestling is like this. That like
I know, totally.
It needs to do that. I think Lucha Underground's getting there, because they're doing weird, like, behind-the-scenes, I'm going to fly away type stuff.
Do you keep up with Lucha Underground?
Not lately, because they don't air it. Like, we don't get El Rey. So
okay. So you have to find other means to watch it.
Yeah, you're right. Exactly. Okay.
So okay. Yeah. Lucha Underground season 1. It's it's underground. It's basically pit fighter, the arcade game. then it becomes let me tell you how it goes in arcs in video games. So it becomes Pit Fighter, the arcade game.
Yeah.
Then later on, I believe season two, like in the beginning of season two, it becomes Twisted Metal of vehicles.
Oh my God.
Seriously. And you know, and the whole basis of Lucha Underground is like Mask, the cartoon show. So season two starts. The beginning of season two becomes like Twisted Metal. I believe season three. I mean, at the end of season two, it's all like conspiracies and all that stuff, and
yeah,
and who goes to jail and what war type of thing. But in season three, and then it. Now season three becomes Mortal Kombat.
Oh, man.
Literally from game to game to game, how did you get to... And this is a wrestling show, but storyline-wise, it goes from that Pit Fighter to Twisted Metal to like Mortal Kombat. And you just need to know like what this doesn't make any sense.
That's so cool.
There have been deaths in the show.
Oh, my God. So that's how they get rid of talent?
There's deaths.
Somebody like signs with another company, they just kill their character.
Right.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
You need to, yeah. I so wish Lucha Underground was on Netflix so I can watch from season one to current, because, dude,
it's so good.
It's awesome. Lucha Underground is such a great show. It's such a great show.
But Tiger Mask W gets that seal of approval. The Brothering Around seal of approval.
Oh man, I just watched like episode six, and it was like they didn't introduce Toru Yano, uh-huh. But there's a character like him, and it was funny. It was funny that a character like got introduced to the show, because
that's cool.
Yeah, they introduce other New Japan pro wrestlers, but they don't, you know, show them like spotlight like Okada, like Tanahashi. Yeah.
Right,
you know, like Yuji Nagata, but yeah, it's a great show, dude.
That's a great show. Oh, it's so funny. Yeah. But but on the other flip side, so yeah, it's been a freaking busy week, man. Yeah. Upon our recommendations, if you haven't heard last episode, I highly suggest you go do it. We talk all about Marvel recommendations, and I wanted to get back into superhero comics, and we kind of checked lists and, you know, compared stuff, yeah. And we had some viewer feedback, and it was good stuff. So I started reading Superior Spider-Man. Now, this is the run by...
Dan Slott.
Yes, Dan Slott. I bought volume one, which is the first eight issues. I want to say I'm at issue five or six. Whenever I tell you what plot point I'm on. So basically out of those, cause I bought three, I bought New Avengers, from Hickman. I bought Hawkeye, because that was one of the highly recommended ones. And then I got Superior Spider-Man, really based on your recommendation.
Yeah.
So I wanted to start with Superior Spider-Man because going way back, I was a Spider-Man kid. I would draw him in my like Trapper Keeper in school. Like I was a big Spider-Man mark. You know what I'm saying? So I had those zoo erasers. I would just draw Spider-Man. So big Spider-Man mark. So yeah, let me get back into it.
At the start of Superior, it must be like a really really much of a flip side, because it's like you're used to a certain type of Spider-Man, so now you're getting Superior.
So basically the premise of it, and you kind of discussed it last episode, but the basic premise is Doc Ock is basically he is Peter Parker. So he gets in, I don't know the exact specifics of it, but like he is now Spider-Man and Peter Parker and all that entails with it. So he can tap into like Peter Parker's memories, past experiences, but he still has the attitude of Dr. Octopus. And for the first probably few pages, I was like, I don't know if I'm going to understand this. Because it was name dropping a lot of stuff and like the Sinister Six. And I was like, I don't really know kind of what's going on.
Okay.
But as I started reading more, it started becoming more human. Like, it started becoming more of a story about Dr. Octopus.
Yeah.
And I'm digging it, man. Like, I need to read more of it. Like, I'm almost done with volume one, and I'm probably just going to go buy number two. I think it's only like $10. But there is some heavy stuff in that.
Yeah.
There's so some...
Like Doc Ock is like... Because Doc Ock was never had the advantages that Peter Parker had or like Spider-Man had.
Mm-hmm.
So like, you know, he's always... I think like what started the whole he needs to transfer to a new body is because he gets hit. He got hit so hard all the time that I guess like he had like extreme concussions.
Oh, because gotcha.
And his body couldn't take it.
Yeah.
Like one more hit and then he died type of thing.
Right.
So, yeah. So he's in Peter Parker's body and like he's getting to know like how Spider-Man acts and how he is and stuff.
Yeah.
But he complains at the same time, like, you know, Spider-Man had all this power. Why did he hold back so much? Or like, he is so smart. Why did he not use his full potential to, you know, either get rich or whatnot? But yeah, right. He complains about like what the things that Peter Parker didn't do, but he decides that he's going to do in his place.
Yes. So it's stuff like killing people is not off limits. So then people around Spider-Man, like how you said last episode that like people are wondering why Spider-Man's a douche. I didn't really know what level you were talking, but now I do, to where he's building these spider bots. So the issue I just fully wrapped up is the one about the vulture. There's a lot that happens, and I don't want to give away all the story stuff away because I highly recommend people read it. But the main thing that I was like, oh, it's one of these type of books is, you know, he goes back and, you know, Doc Ock and Vulture go way back and they're like partners in crime type of thing. So there comes about Vulture sends some of his Vulture minions to go attack Mary Jane's bar. Like the clubs she runs or the bars, she's a bartender. Because that used to be Vulture's old stomping grounds, I guess. Like that used to be his old lab. So just to like stick it to Spidey, Vulture's like, I'm gonna send my birds in and then like cause havoc and all this stuff. So actually goes, takes jewelry from Mary Jane, all this type of stuff. But Spider-Man or Doc Ock knows that this is happening because he's getting weirdly obsessed with Mary Jane. He's like spying on her, like tracking her every move type stuff.
Yeah.
It's like he's getting infatuated, but in a very, very, very unhealthy way. Because he was never the type of guy that would get close to someone like Mary Jane.
Yeah. That kind of girl type of thing.
So he's so envious of Peter Parker, but now he has Peter Parker's looks and he already knows, you know, I'm already in with Mary Jane. So he's pushing stuff like sex and he's really not acting like Peter Parker would. So people are starting to ask questions and things like that. But this Vulture thing happens. Vulture sends his, you know, minions in there to grab some stuff. So then I can't remember the exact specific because it's been like 4 or 5 days since I read the issue. But something ends up happening to where Doc Ock Spider-Man realizes, oh, he starts fighting off the minions because the minions try to capture Mary Jane. And he was like, no, I'm not going to let this happen. Like, that's my girl. What are you doing? Like, Vulture's an idiot. I'm going to go talk to him after this. But I need to get these people out of here. So then he's fighting the minions and then he punches one and then the mask falls off. And it's a kid. Like, it's like a 13-year-old, not even, no, probably like 10-year-old kid. Because the minions are slightly smaller versions of the Vulture, and they can fly around and stuff. And he punches this kid, and like, I don't think he kills him, but I think it like bloodies him up, he looks...
He hurts him bad, though.
Very bad. Yeah, like hospital ER bad.
Yeah.
And Doc Ock loses it. And he has this realization that Vulture's using kids. And then it does a flashback to where Doc Ock growing up is beat by his father.
Mm.
And yeah. It sets it off. It sets off post-traumatic stress disorder. Like, it snaps. It's a trigger for him. Yeah. And he...
I believe Vulture, in that part of the story, he is super old, right?
Like, yes, very...
He can't do his own thing. Like, he's that old, right?
Like, 80-ish years old. And so he sends out these, you know, these kids to do his deeds for him. And he's, like, recruiting children. And, Doc Ock loses it. Or Spider-Man, I should say, loses it. And then goes and kills the Vulture. Like, kills him, puts him through a spotlight. Like, strangles him. Like, literally chokes the life out of this guy. Yeah. While they're flying through the air, and Vulture's like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, me and Peter Parker had this agreement to where he would keep me in line. You know, it was sort of that whole Batman Joker thing, to where it's like, no, we're not going to kill one another because we need one another. It was that sort of relationship for Vulture. Vulture understood, Peter Parker was going to try to get me. He would never get me. I would continue to do my deeds, but I respected Spider-Man. But then Spider-Man chokes the life out of him. Literally kills the Vulture, and the Vulture's like, what is happening? Like, there's that slight point of empathy that you have with Vulture. Then he goes through that spotlight that J. Jonah Jameson so brilliantly made. Like, oh, I'm gonna do a spider signal, and then Spider-Man's like, are you a fucking idiot? Like, now they're gonna know exactly where I am. And he's like, oh, yeah, you're right. So shatters that light with the Vulture, and that's the last episode, or the last issue I was on. But like, whenever they did the whole like child abuse, like, go back to see, here's why Doc Ock started turning out the way he did, where he was kind of a hermit, and he wanted to outsmart people because he couldn't fight people. There's some heavy stuff. I mean, it's good. I mean, it's really well written, and it treats it with a sense of respect. It's not like shock value stuff. Like, it's actually written well, which I can appreciate. But yeah, man, I'm digging it. Like, I'm in.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And it was funny because I wanted to start Spider-Man because I was like, out of all three of these that I bought, Spider-Man seems like it's the most lighthearted. And then that thing happens, but I'm glad it did. Like, I'm glad because I'm glad it's not afraid to, it doesn't want to shy away from stuff like that. Like, it wants to bring it to the forefront and talk about, like, it shows an actual motive of why Doc Ock is the way he is, and why he felt like he needed to be somebody like Peter Parker, why he felt that jealousy and that envy and that, you know, so there's a lot going on it. Like, there's some deep levels on this, and I'm digging it. Like,
there's some depth to Doc Ock that you weren't exposed to previously. Not to say to you, but like the general, like, Marvel reader.
Sure.
Because, you know Doc Ock is just a bad guy. Oh, he's here to do an evil thing, and then that's that, right? Yeah. But you have him in this setting where he has like a second chance at life. He's in like a young, like strong body that he can, you know, he has basically limitless potential on.
Yeah.
And how is he going to take advantage of that? Is he going to go like the same route, or is he going to like either do the good thing or manipulate his way into like getting what he wants while, you know, showing that he's doing a good thing.
And exactly. And there's some moments already to where Doc Ock is learning to hold back.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's learning, like, this might not be the best time to go and save this person getting mugged. Yeah. Like, he's starting to think like a superhero, which is pretty ironic. Like, it's cool, because it's actually now he's starting to understand Peter Parker.
Yeah.
So I'm interested to see where it goes. Like, I'm cool, really, man. I'm really happy that the story's finished. You know what I mean? Like, that I don't have to wait on bated breath. I'm like, oh, I need the new issue to come out next week. Like, that I can just buy the whole collection and read it and just get it and be like, aha. Yeah, here's my thing. I'm doing it through Comixology, and it's working real well. Their comic readers are really slick. I have a Kindle. I can read it on Kindle, my phone, a computer. Like, yeah, I really dig Comixology. It makes it real easy to hop in. And okay. So, and you asked me this kind of before we started recording, and I don't know the answer to it. And the answer, or the question was, like, I'm on volume one of Superior Spider-Man. Am I gonna buy the other volumes and just completely read all of Superior Spider-Man first before moving on to, like, Hawkeye and New Avengers? Or should I do, like, volume one of Spider-Man, then volume one of Avengers, then volume one of Hawkeye, then volume two of Spider-Man, volume two of Avengers? Like, do I need to leapfrog it? I mean, what would you deal with a lot of comics and you juggle a lot of stories. Like, what would you recommend?
I mean, if, say, like, you are just super focused on Spider-Man and just read Spider-Man, that's fine. Just read Spider-Man. But, you know, if you get bored from time to time, you know, you could just jump around and, like, say if you want Superior Spider-Man in a team setting, then I would suggest, I believe he's in the Mighty Avengers, like, books, because that's what Avengers team he's on. Doc Ock's Spider-Man is on, if you want more of that, but in a team setting. But, like, it's just, if you want to just jump around, it's fine. There may be some interconnectivity, but only when events are happening.
Okay, like Civil War.
And the tie-ins of comics type of thing. But, you know, when it's like singular, like this is a story arc for this character, it's not so much a matter of importance that you need to read that before you go to, you know, say like a team up that he did with like Deadpool or something.
Right.
So you can jump around, it's fine. But once you start buying event comics, but event comics or event tradebacks usually have the entire event and the tie-in issues as well.
Oh, interesting.
So you don't have to worry about it that way. But if you're like you're buying issue to issue, then that's where the problem is.
I see. Gotcha.
Issue to issue, and then find what the tie-in issue of like a certain character is.
So
you might as well just wait for the whole trade
volume. Yeah, like I'm really liking the volume setup. Because I can get a big chunk of the story, and then let's say I get the big chunk of this story, and then next payday I buy the next two volumes or something. Like, it's a good way to have the whole story. And I had a lot of people actually recommend that. The Marvel Unlimited or Comixology Unlimited or whatever it is.
Sure.
Which could work, but I think I need to be a little further in to know exactly what I would want to read. You know what I mean? Like, all the recommendations so far, man, Superior Spider-Man is pretty stellar. Like it's good stuff. I'm really liking it. So awesome. I may just finish Superior Spider-Man first.
Okay.
But that way, because I'm definitely a person that if I'm trying to keep track of three stories, I'm going to start mixing information. Like, I'll be taking story beats from one story and putting it in my mind to another story. And then I'll be like, oh, no, wait, never mind. That was the other book. So it may be just better for my mental continuity just to do one full run. And then, but I'm thinking the next one I read. I think next one I read is going to be New Avengers. Because I'm excited.
New Avengers?
Yeah, I'm excited that's going to be the slow burn. And the I think it'll be like tonally different than Spider-Man, which I think will be good. Because I think these three books that we picked, the Hawkeye, Hawkeye, New Avengers, and Superior Spider-Man, I think they're going to be different enough to give me like a good sampling on what writing style I preferred or certain moments that I like from each story and what's more of that. And that'll kind of open that floodgate, I think.
Yeah.
I'm digging to reiterate
about New Avengers. New Avengers is the Illuminati team.
Yeah.
Like the pill, like I said again before, like last episode, the pillars of each part of the superhero community coming all together and making gray moral decisions that'll affect the Marvel universe and its alternate realities. But if you want the superhero team book, the Avengers, Jonathan Hickman's The Avengers is what you want. But yeah, you can just get that whenever you start buying your next round of comics.
Oh yeah, for sure. And I will. Yeah. I mean, because that's going to be the nice thing about getting a good sampling of all these authors.
Yeah.
Is now I'll be able to see what writing style. But like, and I mean, this may have been unfair for me, because, you know, I love, you know, The Crow. I love Pride of Baghdad and like Watchmen, great writing, Alan Moore stuff, Warren Ellis. You know, there's, you know, Grant Morrison. There are these people that have just solid writing. Neil Gaiman doing Sandman. So like there's great writing, but I guess I just saw such an overabundance of just what looked like trash coming out that I didn't give the authors the benefit of the doubt that they were truly good writers. Like I knew of the names that I knew, like Brian K. Vaughan, but I was like, oh, I don't know this Slots guy. I don't know Hickman. I don't know, you know. But this has totally given me like a newfound interest in this type of storytelling. And I think it really is that the kind of post-traumatic stress disorder part, I think that's what got me, is I was like, oh, wow, they're not shying away from this. They're bringing this to the forefront. And this is a motive. I mean, this is, it's not easy to look at and it's not easy to see, but that explains a lot.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm glad it went there. I'm glad it went to a heavier place, and it just makes me excited about what else will it have in store for me. And
yeah, totally. Yeah, so that's why, like, that's why. I mean, I don't buy single issue comics or like trade paperbacks anymore because I just want to know what the story is. You know, like what the character, my favorite character. What is he dealing with right now? How is he?
Yeah.
What's his process of getting through that? You know, and I'll either read it on like a forum post, you know, where they post spoilers of the comic, or if it really comes down to it, like if I really want to get it, then I'll get it.
Sure.
But I just want to know the story of what's going on. And that's
Who's your go-to? Like if you had one character, your go-to that you're always going to keep track of?
Colossus, like I said before, like he's my totally favorite character, and he's doing his thing on the I believe he's on Extraordinary X-Men, but it's doing okay, but it's not doing great. But like that's what the whole X-Men versus Inhumans resurrection line is coming up, so I'm hoping with that little bit of a push that, you know, he becomes more of like a forefront character, because he's always like he's the big muscle guy, so like he's always going to be like the eye candy type of thing on a two page spread.
Right. he's the man meat of
So like I'm hoping he becomes an eventual leader, and like they'll delve into his past and just how he is as a character thing.
That'll be cool. And I will say, it's funny because before I started reading the comics and we were doing the recommendations and stuff, you know, I got really excited about like the X-Men 92. That run type, because I was like, oh God, that's the
based
nostalgia.
The cartoon. Yeah, exactly.
So that's my nostalgia and, you know, all that stuff.
Yeah.
But now it's interesting. Now that I'm getting more into Superior Spider-Man, I'm like, I'll still be excited for that. But I'm actually more excited to read stuff I've never read before. You know what I'm saying? Like, let me figure out what's going on. Like, let me get a little bit of everything. And let me see what's going on in the land of comics now. Because I do think Superior Spider-Man is kind of... I can definitely say, for me at least, it's been one of those... what do they call it? The gateway drug? So far it's been hitting the right notes for me, because it's keeping itself, it doesn't really take itself seriously. It still has that Peter Parker charm because his ghost is there and like we'll start saying things. But now it was the that's where the reveal happened for the child abuse stuff, was Peter Parker was actually in one of Doc Ock's memories. And he was like, wait, why am I here? I know that Doc Ock can have my memories, but now I'm in Doc Ock's memories. Yeah. So probably it's Doc Ock thinking about something and Peter Parker's along for the ride.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think that's a very interesting storytelling device. I think that's really cool, because then you see one, how Doc Ock thinks about it, but also Peter Parker, what does he think about exactly the same thing? And that shows dichotomy of the two characters.
What it's like with both of the characters being in like their memories or their bodies, like how they react to things and how they dealt with the past and how they go about doing things moving forward. Yeah, totally.
Yeah, man. Just very, very cool. So, I mean, this might be one of those weekly check-ins. Like, I read more Superior Spider-Man. Like, it'll be kind of a one trick pony for a while, but I mean, I think it'll be cool going from start to finish on a run. It's exciting because I don't think I've ever done a full run if it's not like Planetary maybe, but that's really it. Everything else, it's either a one-off graphic novel like Watchmen or Pride of Baghdad but I don't think I've ever read a full run that wasn't Planetary, so it'll be good. But I think that's all the real topics for today. I mean, was there any piece of news you wanted to bring up besides like Young Justice or
Young Justice season 3 coming out? Anything else? I mean, I think that's about it. The other thing I wanted to do was shout out Todd EBF.
Oh yeah, what's up, Todd?
And his network of podcasts. I want to call it the Toddcast Network. You know,
the Toddcast. Holy shit, that's gonna stick. It'll stick.
I know. Yeah, you can have that.
Yeah, have it, my friend.
So I just want to shout out Todd EVF. He does a bunch of podcasts. He has like a wrestling one, and I believe he has a comics one because he plays the Marvel MMO with
the Marvel Heroes.
Yeah, Marvel Heroes. Yeah, with a group of people that he plays with.
Good game.
So like, you know, shout out to Todd and those guys. And if you ever want us to guest. And vice versa, you want to guest on our show?
Oh, we'd love it.
The door is open.
Always open.
And we'll talk about it.
Always room for good brothers.
Oh, totally. Always, man.
Got a brother around, man. Always good. Male, female, around, don't even know.
Around brothering.
Around brothering. Would love to have you. Be sure your goatee is in perfect line. So, your evil wispy goatee. So
Right.
So, to continue our tradition. You recommended me Tiger Mask W.
Yeah.
Mine's a little more of a mind fuck.
Okay.
So you have Netflix, correct?
Yes, I do have Netflix.
Okay. So let me Google something real quick. Let's see. So this is very awesome. Awesome radio. Me just like
plays well.
Yeah, plays well. I mean, just great dead air and So let me see. Okay. So it should be on there. Yes, it says the best movies on Netflix right now.
Okay.
So my friend, I want you to find some time. You can watch it with your wife. Your wife will think you're insane. But
okay.
This movie is the greatest revenge movie I have seen in my entire life.
What's the movie called?
It is Oldboy.
Oldboy.
Yeah. So we're getting heavy. Not the one with Josh Brolin. There's a remake that Spike Lee did with Josh Brolin.
The Korean one?
Watch the Korean one. Brother, you're in for a ride. Like, I want to hear what you're... go in blind. Just look up Old Boy. Don't even read the synopsis. Just watch it. All I'll tell you is a guy gets put in prison for 15 years and then he's let out and it's a game to figure out why was he put in prison in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's the whole premise.
Did you guys do a spoiler cast on this? Or am I thinking of another podcast that did that?
Maybe another, because I've mentioned Old Boy way back in the day. It came out in 2003.
I know. That's what I'm reminded of.
So it's worth seeing just keep this in mind as you watch it. Whenever they were talking about doing the American version of this film, they wanted Will Smith as the leading role.
Of course.
So I thought he would have been genius. I thought Will Smith could have done this role amazingly well. However, once you see the Korean original, you're going to understand why Will Smith stayed far the fuck away from this movie. It's the best revenge film I've ever seen. It's beautifully shot. Like, we could do a whole podcast about the movie. Okay. But yeah, so I'll have you, I will ask you to watch Oldboy. It's like an hour and 45 minutes long, but I promise you, you've never seen anything like it. And it's one of those movies that you get to like held as a badge of honor and be like, I saw Oldboy and that movie fucking kicks ass. Like that movie I will say, and the people that have seen it and are like nodding along right now, like, yeah, you got to see Oldboy. Just be prepared that it is not the type of movie you may think when it first begins. That's all I can say about it. But that's why it's the best revenge film I've ever seen. It is a wild ride. But yeah, we'll talk about it next week. But like I've been wanting you to watch Oldboy for a long time. But I never had an opportunity to be like, oh man, you know, you really need to check out Oldboy. But now we got it on tape.
Yeah.
It's our brothering around pact.
Yeah.
It's got to happen. But the reason why I trust that movie so much with you is I think you're going to come back and be like, holy shit, dude. Like, what the fuck? Because the fight scene, I can tell you there is they got two of the fight coordinators from Oldboy to work on the Daredevil Netflix show.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So there's some tie-in.
Trigger me interested.
There is a single shot fight scene that will blow your mind. I still don't know exactly how they filmed it, but that might be what we talked about on the Beardcast was the fight scene.
Right. Because it
just blew us away. Absolutely stellar. Yeah. But all of the, it's very violent, but all of the violence is justified. There is nothing left to chance in that movie. It is written extraordinarily well. So like all of the loose ends come together. It leaves you not on a cliffhanger, but it leaves you, there's a question to answer basically. Mm-hmm. It's a movie that has everything. I and everyone out there, if you've never seen Oldboy, it's on Netflix right now. It came out in 2003. It's by a director named Chan-wook Park. Or Park Chan-wook is a Korean style, but yeah. So Park Chan-wook, amazing director, beautiful movie. You gotta watch Oldboy. I'm real interested because there's a column A and there's a column B. Either there's a column A where you're gonna come back and be like, "Holy shit, dude, that was baller," or you're gonna come back and be like, "What the fuck movie did you make me watch?" And there's a little of both, and that's why it's such an interesting movie. It's you're like, this is intense, but it's a pure, genuine roller coaster. Like, I know it's a lot of hype and a lot of like hyperbole, but you'll know what I mean when you get through it. You'll be like, "Whoa, that's a full course meal." Like, I got to think about this for a while. But that's what I dig. I dig the stuff that makes me think. I dig the stuff that really has a lot to say. That movie kicks ass, but so Oldboy.
Yeah. I'll try to get that in before we get back to recording the next episode.
And I would recommend all do it all in one sitting. If you can, just because, if you do watch it all in one sitting.
Okay.
Yeah. It's definitely a one sitting movie because a lot of the tension builds up. So like if you cut it, you know, if you cut it 45 minutes in, it's still a great genius movie, but like part of it is the build up to what actually happened. And
gotcha.
Okay. Yeah. So, and he does some one punch man fighting shit. It's awesome.
Nice.
He trains himself. He goes insane. So he like trains himself in his prison cell for 15 100. Years. To be a fighting, yeah, exactly. He hits 100. Like he's on another level when he gets out. Dude. It's awesome, awesome.
Yeah. Okay. Awesome. Yeah. Before I go on to the next recommend, for you, I would just recommend that you keep watching Tiger Mask W.
Okay. Yeah. For sure.
We'll talk about it. Like as we talk because I know we haven't brought up like what we've been up to in our weeks, but like that will be where we can recap our,
yeah,
like, you know, recap where we're watching or, you know, talking totally. About Spider-Man or whatnot. So yeah, absolutely. That's what we'll do. I will definitely watch Oldboy. You keep watching Tiger Mask, and then we'll reconvene.
Perfect. On the next perfect. Episode. So we will break. Go team. And remember, sweet. Guys, topsy-turvy land. I know it's stressful. I know it's slightly terrifying. But hang in there. We're going to make it through it. You got brothers.
Oh, dude, what weapon would you use? Would you use on the Hunger Games?
Oh, so... I think... I may go bow staff.
You know, I was thinking that too.
Yeah, man. You know, get some Donatello. Rep some Donatello action in the Hunger Games.
Yeah. You know?
It'd be good times.
Okay.
Yeah, just whittle a tree. Just kind of get a bamboo yeah. rod and just splinter right. people with it.
Right, you know?
Yeah, man.
Cool. I think okay. it'd work. Good to know.
But yeah.
Good to know.
But yeah. So America, hang in there. Everyone, we love you dearly. If this is the Hunger Games, then I go as tribute for Oh, okay. Dude. That's it. We'll see you guys next week. Hang in there. We love you. Hang in there. Let us know what you think about the show. Hit us up on Twitter. Get Marco Flores on Twitter, twitter.com/MarcoPolo177. Hit me up on Twitter, twitter.com/CommieTohobo. We will see you guys next week on episode number 7, lucky number 7 of Brother and Around.
Okay.
Yeah, man.